Thanks for joining us today to discuss this timely, urgent, and compelling book entitled The Button by former Defense Secretary Bill Perry and Tom Collina, the Policy Director of the Ploughshares Fund. I'm Carol Giacomo, a journalist and foreign affairs specialist who for 12 years wrote editorials on foreign and defense policy, including nuclear weapons policy, as a member of the New York Times editorial board. This semester, I was a Ferris Professor of Journalism at Princeton. The Perry-Collina book is so compelling that Monday's paper, the New York Times, ran an op-ed highlighting their ideas. You should be able to see the yellow and black cover on your screen. The book is distinguished by more than a dramatic cover that won't get lost on the bookshelf, however. Unlike many writings about nuclear weapons, this one avoids the complicated jargon and is thus very accessible for ordinary folks. Hopefully, it will serve as a call to action for everyone concerned about whether this world will have a future or not. Because as Secretary Perry and Tom Collina stress, a call to action is exactly what we need. Our first speaker is Sam Nunn, who represented Georgia in the U.S. Senate for 24 years and was chairman of the Senate Armed Services Committee. He has been one of the most important lawmakers when it comes to sane thinking about nuclear weapons and enacting legislation and arms control agreements that have made us all safer. Senator Nunn continues to advocate for reducing nuclear and other threats as co-chair of the Nuclear Threat Initiative, which is co-sponsoring this event. After he comments, Tom Collina and Bill Perry will follow with a presentation of their book. I'll engage them in conversation for 15 minutes, and then all of you in the audience can weigh in. Please use the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom screen to submit questions at any time during the program. Please include your name and affiliation. Senator Nunn, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Carol. After an outstanding career at Reuters and New York Times, Carol brings tremendous expertise on global security to this discussion. Carol, I understand you've traveled more than a million miles to 100 countries or more, including North Korea and Iran. So your retirement from daily journalism is certainly well-deserved. But I know with all of your expertise and experience, you're going to stay very much involved. And you do us great honor by moderating this discussion on a very important book today. Thank you so much, Carol.
Thank you.
In a couple of minutes, we will hear directly from the authors of a book The World Must Take Seriously. It's titled The Button, The Nuclear Arms Race and Presidential Power from Truman to Trump. This sobering history of nuclear launch authority defines the growing nuclear risk that could determine whether our nation, and indeed the world, survive. I believe this book will kick off a long overdue debate about whether the power to unleash nuclear devastation should belong in the hands of only one person. In a democracy, almost every governmental process is subject to checks and balances. That's the strength of our system. Should nuclear annihilation be the exception to this rule? Are there other sensible and workable options? You don't have to think like Dr. Strangelove to understand the button. You don't have to be a Cassandra to recognize that the growing nuclear risk explained by Dr. Perry and Tom Collina demand rational and wise national as well as global leadership. This book could not have been written by two more thoughtful and experienced leaders in the nuclear arena. Bill Perry is a friend. Bill Perry is a partner, and Bill Perry is a national hero. Bill was our nation's 19th Secretary of Defense, and he was the father of much of our military technology advantage today. As a founder of the Perry Project, Bill continues to work to reduce nuclear risk and take steps that will ultimately lead to a world without nuclear weapons. Bill Perry brings experience, he brings wisdom, he brings good judgment to the table on nuclear policy and global security. On a personal note, Bill has the highest A to E ratio of anyone I've ever known. If you're wondering what A to E ratio is, I made it up, but it stands for, A stands for accomplishments, that are huge, and E stands for ego, that in Bill's case is very small. There's no one I would rather rely on when considering the most challenging issues facing our nation and indeed the world. Bill's co-author, Tom Collina, is one of the world's leading experts on nuclear policy and nonproliferation. Tom is the director of policy at the Ploughshares Fund and has been working on these issues as well as many other issues for the last 30 years. As a key nuclear expert, Tom has been closely involved with virtually all of the key steps to reduce nuclear dangers in the last couple of decades. First, the successful effort to end testing in 1992. The second major area he was involved in was the ratification of New START in 2010, and then the Iranian nuclear agreement in 2015. If you want to grasp how fortunate our nation and the world has been to avoid nuclear catastrophe, take a deep breath and then read this book with the hair-raising stories Bill and Tom recount in the button. I urge you to consider carefully their recommendations for our nation's security, and I believe this will be a framework for discussion and debate in the months and years to come. They tackle three questions head on. Number one, should the United States continue to assume that our primary nuclear risk is a deliberate, premeditated nuclear attack, or should we recognize that war by blunder, technical error, or false warning is far more likely? It makes a big difference on that assumption. Number two, should any president be put in the impossible position of having to decide in a few brief moments whether to launch our vulnerable land-based missiles in order to avoid their destruction before being absolutely certain that we have really been attacked and that it's not a false warning? Three, should any president, any US president, have the ability to launch nuclear weapons and begin a nuclear war on his or her sole authority? As the presidential election approached in 2016, Bishop William Swing answered that third question with these words, and I quote him, "We are not so much voting for a president as choosing a God. When you put your hand on the nuclear trigger and become the single agent of the Earth's destruction, that is power beyond human imagining," end quote. With that thought, I'll turn it over to the authors, Tom and Bill. Tom, I understand you will go first, so I guess we could say the Zoom is yours.
Senator Nunn, thank you. Thank you so much for that generous and thoughtful introduction. It's an honor to share the virtual stage with you. And Carol, thank you so much for being here as well. And I am going to start my presentation on the book. I can't actually at this point see the other slide presentation, but I understand we're in good hands with Tabitha, so hopefully we'll all stay in sync. So as the Senator said, I'm Tom Collina, Policy Director at the Ploughshares Fund. I had the honor of writing this book with Bill Perry, and it truly was an honor. The book comes out later this month, and we chose that timing for three primary reasons. First, next month, July 16th, as you all know, is the 75th anniversary of the bomb, the first nuclear test. And then the month after that, we have the 75th anniversary of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And of course, this November, we will choose our next president. And these events coming together create an historic opportunity, we think, to debate the future of US nuclear policy. We have lived with the bomb now for 75 years. And what should the next president do to reduce the risk of nuclear war? Those are the issues that we really want to dig into and we'll do with this discussion today. First, let me set the context for the current moment. As we all know, we're in a national crisis with at least three dimensions: public health, the economy, and racial injustice. On top of all that, we have a leadership vacuum in Washington. And so we think to truly move beyond this crisis, the status quo in US nuclear policy simply must change. And the coronavirus, if nothing else, has showed us that U.S. defense policy has been focused on the wrong threat. We're spending way too much on outdated Cold War scenarios, like great power military conflict with Russia and China, for example, and simply not enough on the true existential threats that we face today, pandemics, climate change, and as we'll discuss, accidental nuclear war. So raging unemployment, which we're seeing now, and systemic racial inequalities show that we've been investing too much in traditional defense and not enough in building a strong economy and just society. Despite spending over $700 billion on defense each year, many Americans simply do not feel safe. Take, for example, the $2 trillion that the U.S. plans to spend on nuclear weapons over the next three decades. Much of this is simply not needed, and we should see this, if you will, as a nuclear piggy bank that the next president could and should break open to pay for higher priority needs. But it's not just about money, as we'll discuss. We need to change policy too. Nuclear weapons have no role to play in addressing the most serious threats we face. And in fact, these weapons can make those threats even worse. So let's get to it and unpack this a bit. Hopefully right now you're looking at President Trump in the football. Is that right? Great. We like to show this photo as it tends to focus the mind. Here is President Trump with the infamous football, the briefcase that contains everything the president needs to start a nuclear war. This is literally how close we are to nuclear war. Every day, every minute, right now, President Trump can order an attack on his own authority, no second opinions, no input from Congress or the Secretary of Defense. We do not mean to single out President Trump in this regard. His impulsiveness and disregard for expert opinion certainly highlight these concerns, but all presidents make mistakes, all are human, and we strongly feel that no single human should control the future of humanity. But we, the American people, choose to give presidents this ultimate power. Why? Why do we choose to live so close to the brink of disaster? And this was one of the main questions we posed in the book. And the answer we found is because U.S. nuclear policy is simply focused on the wrong threat. So in the book, we make this central argument. First, that U.S. nuclear policy is focused on the wrong threat of a surprise attack from Russia. Such an attack is highly unlikely, in our judgment, for the simple reason that such an attack would mean the utter destruction of both sides. And yet U.S. nuclear policy has been based on this threat literally for decades. So here's the big problem. This mistaken threat assessment undermines U.S. security by driving policies that increase the risk of blundering into nuclear war by mistake. We could start a nuclear war in response to a false alarm, one of the greatest dangers in the world. And we simply don't need to take this risk. So instead, we should move away from quick launch policies and give the president more decision time by limiting nuclear use to second strike deterrence only missions. So Bill, let's turn to you, get you involved in this conversation. You had a front row seat to the arms race and met with Soviet and Russian officials many times. Some might challenge our key assertion that a bolt from the blue from Russia is not a realistic threat. What would you say to them?
I'd say when I was Secretary of Defense, I met with all of the leaders of Russia, the President, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, the Minister of Defense, and many others. And since then, I have met hundreds of times with hundreds of Russians of all, both government officials and civilians. One thing I can conclude with great certainty, the Russians are not stupid. They're not suicidal. So we are focused on the wrong threat. A bolt out of the blue, a first strike, is simply not realistic. What is realistic, however, is we might blunder into a nuclear war.
Thank you. This perceived threat of a bolt from the blue attack drives the military requirement, I'll put those in air quotes, that we must be ready to launch nuclear weapons at all times within minutes. That in turn drives these three dangerous policies. First, the president has sole authority to launch nuclear weapons within minutes with no second opinions or oversight. Second, that the president can order a first strike and is not limited to retaliation, and many Americans simply don't understand that. The president can launch hundreds of land-based ballistic missiles, ICBMs, on warning of attack without waiting for proof of attack. And we go through the book in a lot of detail outlining the dangers of these policies. Bill, please give us your sense of why this combination of policies is so dangerous.
I would highlight that by pointing out that we are susceptible to false alarms. This is not a theoretical danger. We have had six of them. I myself experienced one at 3 o'clock in the morning. I was awoken by a phone call from the general who's in charge of the North American Air Defense Command, telling me that his computers were showing 200 ICBMs on the way from the, this was then the Soviet Union, to the United States. This was a Cold War phone call. I will never forget that call. But we have, this was not just the only time. As I said, we've had several times we've had false alarms. Some of them were caused by mechanic errors. A computer chip was the one that was responsible for the phone call that I got. Others are responsible for human errors. But they, however, whatever their cause, they had the potential of causing us to respond falsely, falsely starting a nuclear war that can end civilization.
Thank you. And whenever I hear Bill's story of the false alarm, it sends chills down my spine. I'm glad we got out of it in one piece. Let's expand on the dangers of sole authority for a minute. In 1963, President Kennedy warned that we could stumble into nuclear war due to, quote, accident or miscalculation or madness, unquote. Bill, can you explain how this might happen?
Well, let's take the bad information, for example, which Kennedy himself was subjected to during the Cuban Missile Crisis. We almost ended up in a nuclear war in the Cuban Missile Crisis. Kennedy himself said that he thought there was one chance of three that the Cuban Missile Crisis would result in a nuclear catastrophe. Actually, the danger was higher than that, because when Kennedy made that estimate, he did not know that the Russians, besides having medium-range missiles in Cuba, not yet with nuclear warheads, they also had tactical nuclear weapons with nuclear warheads ready to be used. So if he had accepted the unanimous recommendation of his Joint Chiefs of Staff for a military invasion of Cuba, our troops would have been decimated on the beachhead with tactical nuclear weapons, and a general nuclear war would surely have followed. So bad information is certainly one way that we can blunder into nuclear war. We can also blunder into by a stable, unstable decider, an unstable president. We sometimes think of President Trump as being the poster child of that threat, but there's also President Nixon, who in the last few months of his presidency was very heavily under the influence of alcohol much of the time. Also, I might mention President Reagan, during the last few months of his administration, was in the early stages of Alzheimer's. So the unstable decider is a second one. But the third, is what we've already talked about, is the false alarm. I just mentioned that again because I would point out that today, the danger in some ways is even higher than in the past, because now we have the additional complication of a cyber attack, which could confuse a false alarm even more. So all in all, the real danger of a nuclear war is blundering into it. And there are many, many ways we could do that. And yet, we have had a different threat, a false alarm, the threat of a bolt out of the blue, a first strike driving our policy. It should instead be driven by what we can do to reduce the likelihood of a blunder.
Thank you. So turning to solutions, the next US president, we feel, can and must reorient US nuclear policy away from a Russian surprise attack to preventing accidental war, as we described. And we have some main recommendations to help us get out of this. Bill, if you could lay out the main arguments for how to reduce these dangers.
And presidential sole authority. And indeed, there's legislation pending today, the Markey-Lew bill, to do just that. It has no chance at all of passing this year. But with a different Congress and with a different president, it may very well become the law of the land next year. Secondly, we should establish a no first use as the policy of the United States. We'll not be the first one to use nuclear weapons. Our nuclear weapons are for the purpose of deterrence only. And again, there's legislation pending to that purpose, the Warren-Smith bill. And again, this legislation has no chance of passing this year, but let's look forward to what we can do with it next year. And finally, we should phase out our ICBMs. They are simply accidents waiting to happen.
Thank you. I'm going to quickly wrap this up so we can get to Carol's and audience questions. But let me just say that, you know, I think one of the key points we're trying to make here is that nuclear weapons are the president's weapons. And every 4 years, we have a chance to change U.S. nuclear policy. And the current national crisis is creating what we see as a once-in-a-generation opportunity to rethink our approach to national security. And U.S. nuclear policy is simply so out of step with reality at this point that it is doing us more harm than good. As currently configured, the nuclear arsenal magnifies the dangers we face from the most likely nuclear threat, blundering into nuclear war by mistake. And the next president can and must bring U.S. nuclear policy into the 21st century. We know this will be hard. We're up against about 75 years of outdated thinking and a $50 billion industry. And history tells us that major change like this is only possible if led by the president from the top, with public support and public pressure to deliver. So we are looking to educate the next president and the public like you. So thank you very much for your time. And if you are so interested in buying the book, please go to benbellabooks.com. And if you use the code BUTTON30, you'll get 30% off. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Perry and Tom. As everyone can, I think, understand, if you haven't read the book yet, it's very rich and it's got a lot to talk about. This is a small issue to begin with. In the way you prioritize your proposals, you put the greatest emphasis on ending sole authority. And I totally agree with what you outline. But I just wonder, when a new president takes office next January, would you want him to immediately put his emphasis behind obtaining legislation ending sole authority? Or shouldn't he just do what he could do right away, which is declare no first use and launch on warning? I mean, wouldn't those be steps that would be easier to accomplish than ending sole authority as a first step?
Bill, maybe I'll start and you can jump in. That's a great question, Carol. Thank you very much. Yes, I think if we're looking at the president as the decision maker here, the simplest thing for the president to do is declare a no first use policy for the United States. And we would see the role of Congress to support that with legislation. And Congress could also take the step of ending sole authority for first use by requiring sharing that authority with Congress. So I think we see those as kind of a belt and suspenders approach. They support each other, ending sole authority for first use and a no first use policy for the United States. But the as you say, the appropriate role for the next president would be just to declare that as US policy.
Hard for the president to take an action where he simply voluntarily gives up some authority he has. Perhaps it would be better described for him to think of it as bringing in an advisory group from the Congress to help him make that decision. That would be, it seemed to me, the first step, and one would be well understood by people and well received. And it could very well lead then to the ending of the presidential sole authority.
So appropriately, you put a great emphasis also on presidential leadership. Joe Biden, as Obama's vice president and also in the Senate, has a history of supporting and promoting arms control and nonproliferation. Do you see any evidence that he would be reform-minded in the way that you would like to see if he gets elected? And I would also ask, do you see any hope that President Trump could have a change, you know, could have a change of heart if he gets reelected? I would note that, you know, the Americans and the Russians met in Vienna this week. They have apparently set up working groups to talk about nuclear weapons, which they haven't done in some time. And I'd hesitate to overread that, but I don't know. Your thoughts.
Bill, do you want me to start on this one, or do you want this one?
I have some things I want to say, but you go first.
Well, I'll start with Joe Biden. I think there's some very promising things to say about Joe Biden, and then some things we'll have to wait and see. On no first use, his position at the very end of the Obama administration was very close to no first use. He gave a speech just before President Trump took over, declaring his support for seeing nuclear, supporting sole purpose of nuclear weapons is to deter their use by others. I see that as essentially synonymous with no first use. Some people differ, but it would be a very small step, a huge step of importance, but I don't think the Vice President Biden has to travel very far in his thinking to get to no first use. So we certainly hope that he will take that on as an issue if elected as president. There are other issues that we call for example, not deploying ICBMs. That we simply don't know the Vice President Biden's position on. He hasn't spoken about it. But if Joe Biden becomes the president, he will be inheriting a economy in serious trouble with huge expenses, huge bills to be paid in terms of paying off the debt, rebuilding the economy, fixing racial inequalities. All of these things will take money. And there's a bill payer there if they want to go to it, which is reducing defense spending and particularly reducing nuclear spending within the defense budget, which is excessive and unnecessary. So again, there's a nuclear piggy bank there if the president wants to tap it. And going after the $100 billion program for a new ICBM is a place to start.
Carol, cutting the defense budget has always been pretty much politically impossible. Perhaps very small silver lining around this huge dark cloud we have from the pandemic is that it's going to create an economic situation next year where people have to say we have to deal with this economic problem. And an obvious place to look for money would be the defense budget. So next year may be the year when the political environment will be such that it will be possible to do that.
Carol, just if I could ask your answer your note, you asked a New START question or about a Trump administration.
Right.
I would just add that I personally have very little hope for a second Trump administration doing anything positive. I hope to be wrong. But what we've seen is President Trump is very good at breaking things and not very good at building them up again. And his current position on New START, yes, they are having talks with the Russians, but I see those talks as nothing more than a smokescreen to try to blame China for the fact that they aren't able to make an agreement. Whereas, you know, if the Trump administration was serious about arms control, they would just get together with Russia, extend New START for 5 years, and then figure out the rest later. Until they do that, I simply see this as a cynical ploy to let New START expire and blame China for it.
Earlier this month, the Russians publicized a new document on nuclear deterrence, apparently the first time that they had made this kind of a statement public. I wonder, what do you consider significant, if at all, about this document, and how does it affect your book's analysis and the proposals you advance?
Tom?
Sure. The document seems to confirm most of the things we already knew about Russian nuclear policy, which is essentially that they have no intent of using nuclear weapons unless the existence of their country depends on it, if the existence of their country is threatened. the one significant thing that I think that I saw, we had previously been led to believe that Russia required two or three decision makers to launch nuclear weapons, which I found kind of reassuring. But the document says now that it's up to the president, President Putin in this case. And if that's true, then they have moved closer to the US position. And for the reasons we describe in the book, that's very dangerous, leaving it all up to one decider. And it's particularly dangerous when you consider that the Russian early warning system is in worse shape than ours. And by that, I mean that a Russian leader would have even less time to respond upon strategic warning of incoming attack, would have even less time to determine whether that launch is true or a false alarm. And so it's even more dangerous in the Russian case to have that decision-making authority in one person. And it's part of the reason why we propose a no first use policy, so that we could nudge Russia to take such a policy as well.
I would just point out, Carol, to underline Tom's previous point, that the failure of the Russian early warning system, the weakness of the Russian early warning system, is really a danger to us. And then appreciate it, because that's what could lead to them accidentally starting a nuclear war. Whoever starts a nuclear war, we're all dead at the end.
Not to put too fine a point on it. Overwhelmingly, your analysis focuses on Russia because, of course, Russia and the United States have the overwhelming majority of weapons. But the Trump administration seems fixated on China, and China is indeed a rising power. Despite its military modernization, it only has a fraction of the weapons that the United States has. Does your analysis hold for China, or do you see features and trends in Beijing's doctrine that your critics could use to argue against the proposals in US policy that you advocate?
I would think the opposite, Carol, that the danger of the US and Russian policies right now is that it could stimulate China to build up the nuclear weapons. We talk now about China not being able to, wanting to or needing to join the New START treaty because of the disparity in numbers, you know, 10-to-1 disparity in numbers of nuclear weapons. But there's no reason why that has to be. China has the capability and the resources to build up a huge nuclear arsenal as well. Mm-hmm. Part of our policy, which is so far as unstated policy, is to be sure that that doesn't happen. Do everything we can to minimize the chance that that's going to happen.
I was just going to add to that. I mean, do you see, China has mostly had a second strike philosophy, as I understand it. Do you see any danger that they are or might change, and adopt the United States, position?
In a word, yes. Mm-hmm. They clearly have the capability to do that. Mm-hmm. So it's up to us, up to the United States, and to a certain extent up to Russia, to take policies that do not stimulate to do that, and in fact, even discourage them from doing that. But it's something we very much need to worry about. We need to worry about it because our actions could lead them to take that step, which would make the world even more dangerous than it is now.
Right. I mean, the irony here is that the United States is goading China to do things that are not in our interests, mm-hmm. right? They have a no first use policy. Instead of threatening them with an arsenal that's 20 times the size of theirs, we should be matching their no first use policy and making it credible by taking our weapons off alert and not building ICBMs and other things. But instead, we're kind of ratcheting up the rhetoric that China is the threat. And if you go back to the end of the Cold War, that's when all of this started. Russia started to fade as the enemy. And so certain folks that benefit from having an enemy and high defense spending started creating the China scenario as the threat. And it's simply exaggerated. It benefits some people over others, and it ultimately makes us less safe.
One of the points you also make in the book, I think later, is about the defense industry and also the military commanders and how obviously they're part of the structure, the firmament of the defense industry, And they, I mean, certainly the defense contractors have a vested interest in making sure we build more weapons. And the military commanders build their careers around managing these systems. How do you affect their thinking and their calculation and bring them on board so that they would support the kinds of policies you want to advance?
I think, Carol, that's, in my judgment, that's a misrepresentation of the problem.
Okay.
The bulk of the defense budget and the bulk of the defense industry is not oriented around nuclear weapons. It's oriented around the non-nuclear weapons. And indeed, as you increase nuclear spending, it tends to come at the expense of the conventional forces. Most military commanders I knew really are not in favor of increased nuclear emphasis and nuclear budget. They want to have the funding to maintain the conventional capability and to maintain the readiness. And to some extent, the nuclear expenses, in particular, the increase in nuclear expenses, tends to compete with that.
Mm-hmm. But Carol, I would agree with, you know, when you talk about the nuclear commanders, strategic command, and that kind of, and there, where their careers really are tied to closely with nuclear weapons, I think you're right, that they are proponents of the nuclear industry and may not see it objectively. And I think the only way to change their minds is to have a president that tells them to do something else. Mm-hmm. That's why one of the key points of the book is that nuclear policy is presidential policy, and it has to change at the top, from the top down, and if necessary, you have to move people with the wrong ideas out of those positions and replace them with people that agree with the new policy.
Let me add something to that, which is, it's one thing to be trying to influence political leaders at the top, but one of the things our book emphasizes is how important it is to influence the public, to get the public to understand these issues. Because even if we have a leader at the top, like President Obama in the early part of his administration, anxious to make reductions in nuclear weapons, determined to, and understanding the importance of it, he did not have the public support to do that, and he eventually gave up trying to do it.
Right.
So public support is hugely important. And if anything, I would say the main emphasis of our book is trying to get the public support, public understanding of nuclear dangers, and therefore the public support for sound nuclear policies. That's what's needed to give the president, who wants to do something, the backing, the leeway to do that.
All right, I'm gonna start to take some questions from the audience, because people seem very eager to weigh in. So this is from Stephen Slaner, from who teaches at Northern Essex Community College. And he writes, as I understand it, Secretary McNamara came out in favor of a unilateral reduction of nuclear weapons to 50 to 100. Do you agree that such a policy would advance U.S. security interests?
Sorry, was the question that would be a unilateral reduction?
Yes, he says McNamara wanted a unilateral reduction to 50 to 100 nuclear weapons. Do you agree that such a policy would advance U.S. security?
Bill, you want to take that one on?
I would believe that our nuclear policy ought to be based on what is best for the United States. And if we think that reducing nuclear weapons unilaterally is a sound policy, we should do it, whether or not the Russians reciprocate. And President Obama, in fact, in his last few years of office, was considering reducing to 1,000 nuclear weapons deployed unilaterally in the hopes that Russia would follow, but not depending on Russia. His view was 1,000 nuclear weapons were more than enough deterrence, whatever the Russians had, whatever the Russians did. Taking that down to 50, 100 would be a much trickier proposition. Tom?
Just to say, you know, that maybe I'll answer it this way, that parity is certainly overrated, right? We don't need the same number of nuclear weapons that Russia has. We just need enough to deter Russia from attacking us. And that, I think that's a very low number, in the few hundreds. And having as many as Russia is a more of a political construct than a security construct. And for deterrence, parity is not necessary.
Okay, this one comes from Alan Ware, Global Coordinator for Parliamentarians for Nuclear Nonproliferation and Disarmament. The opponents of no first use policy argue that the United States must keep such a policy to protect US allies in Europe and Northeast Asia from a conventional attack, for example, from Russia or North Korea. Parliamentarians from Europe, Japan, and South Korea have voiced support for a no first use policy, but the US administration ignores these voices and only listens to the warmongers and defense officials from Europe and Northeast Asia. How can we elevate the parliamentary voices of reason from these regions?
Oh, I must say my own experience is somewhat different from that. When we were considering a no first use policy at the time I was secretary, and I thought we were probably going to institute it at that time, we were besieged with pleas from some of our allies, Japanese in particular, and the Germans to a lesser extent, not to do that because they thought it would lessen our extended deterrence capability. I never understood the logic in that, but that they believed that and they were arguing the case, it was certainly true. So that was my own experience with it. Tom, what do you see about this?
Well, I think when we often talk about the allies as if they're one, you know, homogeneous entity. Of course, when you go talk to the allies, it depends on who you talk to, right? If you talk to the defense ministry, you'll get one answer. If you talk to the foreign minister, you might get another. But I think the basic point is to understand that the allies will be uncomfortable with a no first use policy by the United States. And that a new president, say a President Biden, will need to understand that he needs to exert energy in this area, start a charm offensive, go meet with allies, explain the situation, reassure them this will not undermine their security, and then I think they'll be okay with it. But it'll take some work.
Well, just to follow on that, what do you think would provide them with the greatest assurance?
Well, you know, if you think about it, the U.S. commitment, the U.S. extended deterrent commitment says if you are attacked with nuclear weapons, we will respond, and that is the deterrent. There's no reason why no first use is a problem for that, right? The United States is not saying if you're attacked with conventional weapons, we will use nuclear weapons to protect you. So there's no reason that no first use should undermine in any way the U.S. extended deterrent to our allies. And I think we just need to explain that and make it clear that it doesn't reduce the commitment.
Yeah, the belief that we need nuclear weapons to deal with a conventional attack, either on us or on our allies, is just not correct. I remember when I was the secretary, there was one of the Northern African countries was acting up by building a chemical weapon plant. And we made a strong protestation to them to stop doing that. But I was asked by the media at that time, if they go ahead and build this chemical plant, would you attack them with nuclear weapons? And my answer was simply, we do not need nuclear weapons to attack them. Any policy we wanted to implement with military means we have the capability to do with our conventional forces. We certainly don't need nuclear weapons to deal with a Northern African country. For that matter, we don't need nuclear weapons to deal with any country. Our conventional forces are quite capable of dealing with any kind of a conventional attack.
Okay, so we have a question now from Toshiya Umehara, an editorial writer for Asahi Shimbun in Japan. I'd like to ask you about the implications of international humanitarian law with what you just addressed. How significant or non-significant do you think the legal and ethical considerations will play under a scenario of a US president deciding whether to launch nuclear strikes as a restraining factor? If the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, the new treaty, takes effect, how do you think it will affect the decision of the United States as a non-signer?
Tom?
Thanks. Well, I actually think the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons is very important symbolically at this point, because it shows that the vast majority of nations internationally do not want nuclear weapons in the world. And they're willing to say that quite clearly, that they want to ban nuclear weapons in the same way that biological weapons are banned and chemical weapons are banned. And if the treaty goes into force, say in the next 12 months, then there will be an international prohibition legally on the possession of nuclear weapons. And I think that's very important politically and symbolically. And over time, that should create more pressure on the nuclear possessor states to take that seriously. Now, will they sign that treaty as a way of getting rid of their weapons? Probably not. I think the United States and Russia should work together bilaterally to reduce their forces, because they have 90% or more of all the forces in the world. But the treaty itself creates a very useful political pressure to make that process happen.
All right, this comes from Ed Levine. Why do away with ICBMs rather than nuclear air-launched cruise missiles or low-yield nuclear weapons?
Because ICBMs are the most dangerous weapons we have. They're the ones that are most likely to lead to an accidental nuclear war, to a blundering nuclear war. They are an accident waiting to happen, as I've already said. And the reason is because they're sitting there ready to be launched in a few minutes' notice. And they're sitting in silos at known locations so they can be targeted. Originally, we built the silos thinking that would protect them from being attacked, but that was before nuclear weapons, ICBMs developed the accuracies which they now have. Today, they are sitting ducks. So they are just a danger, because if any nation wanted to do a first strike, they would have to attack the ICBMs first. And therefore, if we see an alert, a warning of an attack against ICBMs, we assume this coming against our ICBMs, and we assume that we will need to launch them before they land. It's that scenario which is the most likely way that we can blunder into a nuclear war. If you eliminate the ICBMs, you eliminate that scenario, basically.
And the reason we want to address this issue now is because the United States is just beginning a brand new program to replace all these missiles. Rather than learning the lessons that Bill just talked about, we're doubling down on learning the wrong lessons of the Cold War. We're rebuilding these missiles all over again at a cost of up to $150 billion. And we would be safer not to build these weapons at all. I would pay a lot of money not to build these weapons. They make us less safe.
Okay. We have a question from Vincent Lavanac in Paris, who says, what could the United States put on the table in order to attract China to an arms control START-like treaty?
So I would challenge the notion that we should be, you know, trying to get China involved at all. I mean, again, as I mentioned, the United States and Russia have 90, 95% of all the weapons in the world, nuclear weapons in the world. And so they are the ones that have to take the initiative here. Once they come down with their arsenals, again, you know, they have 20 times the number of nuclear weapons that China does. So once the US and Russia come down into the neighborhood, great, let's talk. And then I think if the United States and Russia want to offer things that China has already done, for example, no first use, taking weapons off alert, and having second strike policies that don't threaten others, then I think China might be interested in talking.
I would add to that we should be sure that our policies are such that we do not stimulate China to go beyond this minimal deterrent program and start building up a nuclear force, because they, as I said before, they have the resources to do that if they think it's in their best interest to do so.
And I might just mention our missile defense policy. Again, we're spending hundreds of billions of dollars deploying missile defenses that really don't protect us because they're simply not effective. Yet Russia and China think they might be effective, and therefore, in China's case, they're forced to consider building up. And in Russia's case, it makes them reluctant to build out. So we are taking steps, supposedly in our own defense, that are actually increasing the dangers externally.
Peter Pella, who is a professor emeritus at Gettysburg College, wants to know, how are negative security assurances, how do they relate to no first use?
Well, I see them as very closely related. In other words, we're telling other countries, if you do not have nuclear weapons, negative security assurances are basically to encourage nations not to build the bomb. And so if a country says, like Canada says, we're not going to build a bomb, then the United States says, we will not attack you with nuclear weapons. But that is all covered presumably by a no first use, which would be a blanket policy that says the United States will never use nuclear weapons first. And I think that's the most compelling way to go and to say we will never start a nuclear war, period.
Nasir Mahmood wants to know, how can you make India and Pakistan negotiate some sort of bilateral arms control agreement? And what do you know, what do you think about the command and control systems in South Asia?
And the answer to the first question is, I don't know. Tom, do you know?
Well, we certainly can't make them do anything, right? These are independent, self-respecting, very proud countries. But we want to help them understand that they shouldn't do what we did. And I think part of the problem here is that other countries look at the United States and they say, oh, well, the United States is the most powerful military country in the world, has a great economy. Whatever they've done was probably a good idea. And so you see other countries, India, Pakistan, and others, developing a triad of delivery systems, the whole thing. And seem to be trying to recreate what we did. And I guess my advice to them is don't do it. We're not doing it because it's smart. We're doing it because we're stuck in a rut and we're doing things that don't make any sense. So look at this from the ground up. Don't do it because we did it and you'll probably come out in a better place.
Okay, Leon Ratz, who's the senior program officer at the Nuclear Threat Initiative, asks, in order to realize some of the recommendations you proposed, do you think we'd need to see some structural changes inside the U.S. government? We got rid of the Arms Control and Disarmament Agency in the 1990s, and many of our arms control experts have since retired. Few people are left in government who have significant arms control experience. How do we address some of these organizational and personnel challenges?
That's a great question, Leon, and I don't have a great answer to it. I would look, first of all, though, to building a strong organization within the State Department focused on that. It doesn't have to be an independent agency like the ACDA was. If we had a strong group within the State Department that was supported by defense, but fundamentally resided in state. Tom, what do you think about that?
I think certainly beefing up the expertise in the State Department and in the Pentagon that supports arms control means other than military means to solve problems would be terrific. I would not want to say that those things are requirements for moving forward. I think the president, a new president, could decide to do these things and put the teams together to make it happen. So yes, structural change would be great, but it's not a requirement for moving forward.
I would add to that, besides what we do in the executive branch, it would be well to strengthen and beef up some of the groups in the Congress that are interested in these issues. They're at least as important, I think, as what's in the executive branch.
Mm-hmm. And I might just add for a new president, say a President Biden, it's very important the people you put in key positions in key agencies, because as we learned in the Obama administration, people are policy. And a lot of those people were terrific. But in some cases, they didn't follow through in the president's vision. So a new president needs to put people in place that will implement their vision.
Okay, from Kyle Marston asks, the Trump administration seems to be intent on militarizing outer space despite our obligations to the Outer Space Treaty. How does your position on nuclear policy inform your thinking about this new domain? Are we headed to a new era of brinksmanship?
I think it would be a grave mistake for the United States to militarize space or to take actions which encourage other countries to militarize space. We have huge resources in space that affect everything we do, not only in the military field, but in the civilian field as well. And the minute people start getting the capability to attacking those systems, we put a great deal of risk. So I think the militarization of space would be one huge mistake, and we should do everything we can to try to keep that from happening.
Roland Joseph, who's from Boston, he's a graduate student in conflict analysis at Nova Southeastern University. Some nuclear states are for the modernization of nuclear weapons, while some others are for reducing them. Between reducing and modernizing, which of those paths can lead us towards the elimination of the threat of nuclear weapons? I suspect I know your answer.
Well, certainly we strongly feel that we should continue reducing the forces we have because they're expensive, they're dangerous, and by reducing forces with Russia, we can build confidence with them at lower levels. But in the book, we do outline places where we would support limited, moderate modernization of forces. Not the ICBMs, which we think are dangerous and should not be modernized, but to the extent that other nations have nuclear weapons in the world, then we will want to maintain our submarines and our nuclear-capable bombers. And there are programs in place, very high-cost programs, to do those things.
I should emphasize that the modernization of our submarine force is not the main issue. The main issue is the continuing to maintain the invulnerability of our submarine forces. So anything we do to modernize the submarine forces should be done hand in hand with a very strong ASW, anti-submarine warfare research program.
All right, so we're gonna take two more questions and then we'll have to wrap it up. Dan Jasper wants you to say more about the risks of accidents outside of false alarms. For example, decay in facilities or transporting weapons material.
Well, there are two different kinds of accidents to consider. The one that we have focused on, which is the false alarm, is an accident that could start a nuclear war, that could end civilization, really. There are other accidents, like the ones where that could affect a given ICBM, say, or a given nuclear bomber, in which one bomb could go off, cause a lot of damage, but it's not of the same magnitude and not consideration as it's starting with nuclear war. So one of them causes huge damage and puts hundreds of thousands of people lives. The other one ends civilization. So they're completely different incidents. Tom?
Yeah, I would just say that we used to have, for example, we used to carry nuclear weapons on alert bombers on a day-to-day basis. And what happened is those bombers would eventually crash or would drop nuclear weapons off them. So there are accidents like that that we have solved through procedural means. And that's kind of what we're saying on the ICBMs. We're saying they're so dangerous, but we can address those things by procedures, for example, taking those weapons off alert or no longer having a policy of launch on warning. Those things would help. But ultimately, once you do those things, you're led to the conclusion that we don't need these weapons for deterrence, and therefore it would be cheaper and safer just to eliminate them.
Okay, and one more. Richard Denton wants to know your impression of the IAEA. It seems to have conflicting roles and is not doing some of them very well.
Well, there's certainly a long-running debate. The IAEA, International Atomic Energy Agency, I think does a fabulous job of their nuclear inspections. For example, the inspections they were doing of Iran under the Iran nuclear deal, and as we know, Iran was abiding by that deal up until the time that the Trump administration decided to tear it up. There are, of course, conflicting views of the agency's role in promoting nuclear power and whether it should do both of those things. It would be interesting to see an analysis of whether those roles could be separated. So you have one agency that promotes nuclear power and another that prevents the spread of the bomb, and that actually might make more sense.
Well, unless we miss the message, at the end of their book, Bill and Tom try to shake us out of our torpor yet again. Quote, "U.S. nuclear policy is a disaster waiting to happen," they write. And again, they also write, quote, uprooting the bomb will take sustained effort by a committed president and a public intent on keeping up the pressure. So for anyone who agrees with Bill Perry and Tom Collina, that's your charge. We all need to keep up the pressure. And their book is available for purchase. So thank you very much for joining us.
Carol, thank you so much. And thanks to NTI for organizing this great event.
Likewise.